A very good evening to all our viewers. I'm Divya Bansal, currently the Dean of Alumni International Relations and also Professor of Computer Science at PEC. Human Rights Day is observed every year on 10 December, the day the United Nations General Assembly adopted in 1948 the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The UDHR is a milestone document that proclaims the inalienable rights which everyone is entitled to as a human being, regardless of race, color, religion, sex, language, political or other opinion, national or social origin, property, birth, or other status. In a rapidly evolving world, development is at an ever-increasing pace, but so is suppression and exploitation. And thus, in honor of the solemn occasion and to commemorate the Human Rights Day, we have with us India's leading social worker, Dr. Sandeep Pandeyji, who is also the recipient of 2002 Raman Magsaysay Award, also known as Nobel Prize of Asia for Emergent Leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, we are very privileged to have Dr. Sandeep Pandey to our fifth edition of Punjab Engineering College Centenary Lecture Series. As PEC marches towards completing our journey of 100 glorious years and the power of our celebrations, we have the Centenary Lecture Series, which features eminent global personalities from all walks of life. I would also like to acknowledge the presence of Dr. Dheeraj Sanghi, Director PEC, with us today. Dr. Sandeep Pandey, our distinguished speaker, is an alum of Banaras Hindu University, now known as IIT Varanasi, and a doctorate in control theory at the University of California, Berkeley. And Dr. Pandey is one of the greatest advocates of education. He co-founded Asha for Education, a registered nonprofit organization founded in 1991, working with the motto of bringing hope through education. He also leads the National Alliance of People's Movements, the largest network of grassroots movement in India. He has taught as a visiting professor at Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad, IIT Gandhinagar, Nalsar University of Law, and also IIT BHU Varanasi. In April 2019, he launched his book titled Mujhe Kashi Hindu Vishwavidyalaya Se Kyun Nikala Gaya at New Delhi, Lucknow, and Varanasi. This book throws light on the work he did during his stint as professor at IIT BHU. Our host for the evening is our own alum, Mr. Manish, who graduated from mechanical engineering in the 2003 and later did law in the year 2007. He has more than 13 years of experience as an advocate of Honorable High Court of Punjab and Haryana Chandigarh. He has been conducting cases of constitutional law, civil law, service law, taxation law, criminal law, as well as revenue law, including arbitration and cooperative law matters. He has been donating blood right from the time when he was studying at PEC, and by now he has donated more than 30 times. Once again, we are delighted to have Dr. Sandeep Pandey as our speaker of the day with us, who will be interacting with us on human rights, and I'm sure will awaken us with his deep insights. Over to you, Dr. Pandey.
Thank you. Thank you so much. One question I should ask immediately in the beginning is, which language the students will prefer, Hindi or English?
So I think English should be good. And in case you want to use a mix of Hindi or English.
I think we can use mix of Hindi and English, you know, the typical way the campus people are.
Is there any student from South India or Northeast who will not be able to understand any Hindi at all?
I don't think so.
Okay. Theek hai. Yeah. So then I may use some Hindi also. So I would like to dedicate this lecture today to Professor G.T. Agarwal, who was a professor at IIT Kanpur. You know, with which both Professor Dheeraj Sanghi and I have also been, you know, fortunate enough to have been associated with. And he is one man I really admire. Let me admit before everybody that I don't touch the feet of my father. But when I went to see him when he was on fast in Haridwar in 2018, I could not stop myself from touching his feet because he had put his life at a stake. And I was so pained because I thought that, you know, government will talk to him, will end his fast so that his life could be saved. But unfortunately, you know, after 112 days of fasting, he died. He wrote 4 letters to the Prime Minister, 2 before he started his fast and 2 while he was on fast. But there was no response. Only Miss Uma Bharti came to meet him, who was just a minister of sanitation. The minister for water resources did not come to see him. Mr. Nitin Gadkari, he just spoke to him over phone. And Professor Agarwal, who had become a sadhu in 2011, and he was known by the name of Swami Gyan Sarup Sanand, he died just because, you know, his demands were not met. And what were his demands? He was demanding a stoppage of work on all hydroelectric projects in the upper reaches of Ganga. So, as you know, there are 5 rivers which combine to become Ganga. Bhagirathi and Alaknanda join to become Ganga. And then there are 3 more rivers which join Alaknanda. Mandakini, Nandakini, and I think Dholi Ganga, I don't remember, but there are 5 rivers which become Ganga. So he was demanding that no dams should be built in this area. And his argument was that there is a bacteriophage, a virus, and today we are fighting a very ominous virus called COVID. But you would be surprised to know that there is a virus in Ganga which kills the bacteria, and especially the bacteria which comes from human excreta, the E. coli. And his argument was that if you will build dams, then the flow of this bacteriophage will stop because the sediment will assemble before the dam, upstream of dam, and you will stop the flow of sediment also with the water. And therefore, this will take away the unique property which River Ganga has of self-purifying. You know, that is the only reason we consider Ganga as holy. So he was a scientist as well as a very religious person. He used to consider Ganga as his mother. And he could not see the devastation which was taking place. Number one, because of dams. Number two, because of all the sewage which flows into Ganga. You know, we have sewage treatment plants, but they are not enough. Capacity is very small, and whatever capacity is there is not properly utilized. And there are, instances where if you don't have electricity, then the sewage flows into Ganga untreated. So pained by all this, he had undertaken 5 fasts earlier also during the previous government. And it was because of him that when Mr. Jairam Ramesh was the environment minister, that 135 kilometer of Bhagirathi River was declared an eco-sensitive zone, which means no dam would be built on Bhagirathi. And 3 hydroelectric projects, one of which was already underway, 1,000 crore rupees were spent on it, Lohari Nagpala, it was stopped. The Prime Minister Manmohan Singh said that for me, environment is more important than electricity. And 2 projects which had not yet started were also scrapped. So some of his demands were met. He had drafted a bill for conservation of Ganga. During the Manmohan Singh government, he wanted the present government to adopt this bill and make it into a law. And during his 5th fast during Manmohan Singh government, the then BJP President Rajnath Singh sent him a letter saying that when Narendra Modi will become the Prime Minister of country, all his demands related to Ganga will be met. He waited for 4 years, 4.5 years, but when he saw that nothing was happening towards cleaning Ganga in the real sense. I mean, sewage treatment plants were being built, But, you know, in this country, there is a lot of corruption associated with any construction activity. So the contractors and the politicians and bureaucrats had vested interest in all the construction that was going on. A major part of the Clean Ganga mission project was going towards building sewage treatment plants. Some of it was also going towards riverfront development, which has nothing to do with cleaning Ganga actually. Nothing was really being done in a concrete manner to clean Ganga. And therefore, after waiting for 4.5 years, he undertook his sixth fast. But unfortunately, that turned out to be his last fast. And I met him 2 times during the fast. And I was hoping that the government will dialogue with him at the last moment and will save his life. I will share with you that it was really disappointing for me that that the government did not talk to him. But more disappointing was the response of the society. I mean, I see that when there is a temple, when there is a movement to build Ram temple in Ayodhya, so many people will come out of their homes and participate in the movement. When there is a movement to stop women for going into Sabarimala temple, so many people will come out to protest against the Supreme Court judgment, which actually allowed women to enter that temple, women of the menstruating age. This was as much a religious issue because Ganga is such a holy river. And unlike the Ayodhya temple issue or the Sabarimala temple, the Ganga actually affects the lives of 41% citizens of this country. In this thickly populated area of Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand, West Bengal, almost 41% of Indian population is benefited by Ganga or its tributaries. So even in material terms, you know, the cause of saving Ganga was so important, but I just could not understand why there was no response even from society or from media. I mean, it was only after he died that small column of news was published inside, you know, third or fourth page of Hindu, and some other newspapers carried it. And when you think about Professor G.D. Agarwal, a B.Tech from IIT, what is IIT Roorkee now, PhD from University of California, Berkeley, and promoted, he worked as an engineer with the UP Irrigation Department, was part of the team which constructed Rihand Dam, and for the first time used fly ash with cement in construction, which saved the cost of the dam. For which the chief engineer of the irrigation department was awarded a Padma Shri. But the chief minister said that the real credit goes to Professor G.D. Agarwal. He left the irrigation department, became a lecturer at IIT Kanpur first, or an assistant professor. And after his PhD was promoted to professor, directly from assistant professor to professor. But he quit IIT Kanpur also in the 70s. And then he became the member secretary of the Central Pollution Control Board. And it is because of him that a number of norms which have been laid out to check pollution are in place. So such a person of high academic integrity, moral integrity, he was not married, he became a sadhu and completely dedicated to what he was doing. It was very unfortunate that we as a society failed him and we could not save his life. So this lecture is dedicated to him. But today I would like to talk about a number of other activists who are, almost as dedicated as Professor G.T. Agarwal was towards his cause, who are very educated like Professor G.T. Agarwal, who were either in academic positions, were lawyers, were human rights activists, but about 16 of them are in jail just in one case, which is the Bhima Koregaon case. And then there are a number of other intellectuals who are in jail related to various charges, some under UAPA, Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, some under sedition charges. Some have been alleged to have links with Maoists and various other things. So, but I would like to concentrate on few individuals just to show you the kind of people, you know, who have been put behind bar. Professor Anand Teltumde taught at IIT Kharagpur, BTech from Vishwesharaya Engineering College in Bombay. Studied at IIM Ahmedabad, got a PhD from University of Bombay, had a long experience in the corporate world. He was head of some companies, essentially a data analytics person, used to teach management at Goa when he was arrested. And he was also married to the granddaughter of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. So very illustrious, you know, family background also. He was a leading Dalit rights activist. He has written about 20 books, most of them on how there is a caste-based discrimination against Dalits. Not just discrimination, violence also. He wrote one of his books on the Kherlanji incident, in which two Dalit women were raped and gang raped and then murdered. A very shocking incident, something like what happened in Hathras recently. So a conscientious voice of human rights, with a strong academic background and a corporate background, such person is in jail. Why? Because he went and spoke as a speaker in the Bhima Koregaon incident. He was not the organizer. He did not play any part in anything, related to that incident, except for going and speaking there. And he has been alleged to have Maoist links, and the case has been booked against him because in some conversation somewhere, somebody has referred to one comrade Anand. And the investigation agencies say that this must be Anand Teltumde, without trying to find out which Anand that conversation referred to. And he is in jail, unfortunately. Next person I would like to point out is Sudha Bhardwaj. Who completed, she was born in the USA because her parents were professors in the United States. So she was born a US citizen. But when his parents came to India, she chose to give up her US citizenship and studied mathematics at IIT Kanpur, got a 5-year integrated master's, and then went to Chhattisgarh to become an activist, working for the rights of the tribal people. And studied law, also became a lawyer because often, she had to go to the court to defend the Adivasis who were falsely accused in various cases, often under, UAPA or there was an act called TADA earlier. So she found it fit to study law also, and was such an eminent lawyer that she was asked to come to train the people who intend to become judges in the state legal services. In fact, she was offered the position of a judge in Chhattisgarh court. So she could have been in the United States, living a very comfortable life. She could have been a professor of mathematics at one of the IITs or any science institutions in India. She could have been a judge. But she chose to be a grassroots activist. And when she was arrested, she was a professor at the National Law University. and a very humble person. And I will share you one personal experience with Sudha Bhardwaj. She came to Lucknow one day along with her colleague, a villager from Chhattisgarh. And they had to spend one night at my place. And I offered her a cot in my drawing room. And because among the two, she was a lady, so I thought it would be appropriate to offer the cot to the lady. And then, and it was implied that the man will sleep on the floor, but she turned down the offer of cot. She said, no, both of us can sleep on floor. There's no problem. I will sleep on floor. So can you imagine such a acclaimed person, such an educated person, she could have been anything she wanted to be. But she chose to fight for the rights of the marginalized sections of our population, especially the tribal in Chhattisgarh. And she's paying a price for it, that she's in jail. And when her lawyer went to the Supreme Court to ask for her bail on the grounds of health, the Supreme Court said you should be asking for bail on the basis of merit of the case, not just because of health reasons. What the judge meant was there was not even a strong enough case against her that she should be in jail. Varvara Rao and Stan Swamy, both over 80 years old, are in jail. And just imagine, your grandfather or grandmother who are over 80 year age, and just imagine the kind of care they need at home, from food to whatever, you have to take care of them so that they don't fall ill and things like that. And in this time, COVID times, Varvara Rao was affected by COVID, but still, he was not released. He was just sent to an hospital. They both these gentlemen, all they have done is Varvara Rao was a teacher, a principal of a college in Andhra Pradesh, and Stan Swamy runs an organization in Jharkhand. He's based out of Ranchi. And they have been advocating for the rights of the marginalized sections of our population, Dalits and Adivasi. In fact, all Father Stan Swamy was doing was to ask for the implementation of the Forest Rights Act, which is a law in India. It was made during the Manmohan Singh government. It allows every tribal person living inside a forest 4 hectares of land. If it can be proved that he was living there as of December 2005. But as all laws, this one is also not implemented properly. So a lot of tribals who could get land are not able to get it. Therefore, he was asking for the implementation of land rights of tribals under the Forest Rights Act. And the other thing he was against was exploitation of natural resources for corporate profit. Right now as we speak, the farmers are protesting in Delhi because of the 3 farm laws which are going to benefit the private corporations more than the farmers. So similarly, he was against the minerals, and it is a coincidence that most of the minerals are located in tribal areas, not just in India, but the world over. You go to Africa, you go to Australia, and you will find that the rich minerals are there where tribals are living. So, all they were saying is that you should not displace the tribals from the land on which they are living just because there are minerals underneath. And even if you have to do, there should be some arrangement so that the benefit of the commercial exploitation of the minerals should be shared with the people living there, the indigenous people. There's a famous case from Odisha, Niyamgiri, where the Supreme Court said in 2013 that the Vedanta company, which wanted to mine bauxite to make aluminium and had already set up its processing plant, assuming that they will get the mining rights, the Supreme Court said that it is the villagers, the tribals living there, who will have the ultimate say, because our constitution provides special rights to tribals. So the Supreme Court asked the Orissa government to conduct Gram Sabha meetings, and after Gram Sabha meetings were conducted in 12 Gram Sabhas, all of them rejected the idea of proposal of bauxite mining in that area, and the company was not able to do what it intended. So this is essentially what all these activists want, that the rights of the tribals, the indigenous people in India, the Dalits and other marginalized sections should be protected. Any violation of their rights should not be allowed to happen, and if there is a violation, then the perpetrators must be punished. This is all these activists have been wanting. In the list, there are others: Shoma Sen, who used to teach English at Nagpur. There is Rona Wilson, a scholar from the Jawaharlal Nehru University. There is advocate Surendra Gadling. There is Dalit activist Sudhir Dhavale. There are journalists Vernon Gonzalez and Arun Ferreira. There is a young person, 33-year-old, Mahesh Raut. Now, Mahesh Raut was a student at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, very prestigious institute for social sciences. A lot of people go there to study social work. My wife is a MSW from there. Medha Patkar was a PhD student there when she started Narmada Bachao Andolan. And he was also a Prime Minister fellow. He got fellowship from the Prime Minister's office to work with the district collector for 2 years. This is a scheme started during the Manmohan Singh government, where bright students were placed directly for internship with district magistrates so that they could understand the functioning of the administration and help it improve. So for 2 years, he worked as a Prime Minister fellow, and he was working in a tribal area, Gadchiroli. And all he was doing was fighting for tribal rights, implementation of Forest Rights Act, the Pesa Act, Panchayat extension to scheduled areas. And let me tell you, there is a village in Gadchiroli district, which is called Menda Lekha, where the ideal concept of self-rule has been implemented, where the tribals themselves decide how the resources of the village will be used, and they do not allow any government official to interfere in their functioning. They take all their decisions by themselves, and they never go to the police, they never go to the court. They allow outsiders, but only for research and study, but their decision making is their own. So such is the kind of system that all these people were working for, where people should be in charge of their lives. They should be able to take their decisions and should not be open to exploitation by the government officials, corporations or contractors, and the administration, police and other things. Because this is also an area, as you know, which has a presence of Naxalites. So the people in these areas actually, are kind of suppressed between two forces. On the one side, you have the state security forces, and on the other side, you have the Maoists or Naxalites, both using violence, and the people are, they have to pay a price for being in these areas. These areas, we need, a system where people can be empowered, people can take their own decisions, and all the benefits which the government schemes have meant to reach the people, and which do not reach because of corruption or because of inefficiency, they start reaching the people. This is all that these activists were working for. But unfortunately, a lot of them have been charged under UAPA, have been alleged to have links with Naxalites. And in this Bhima Koregaon incident, which happened on 31st December 2017, and on 1st January, there is a celebration during the time of British rule, a British regiment in which Mahars were there, which is a scheduled caste. They defeated the Peshwa army. So this day is celebrated as the conquest of Dalits over the ruling elites of that time. And there is a monument built there. So this event used to take place every year. But this time what happened in 2018, 1st January, there was some violence, which was instigated incidentally by some outsiders. And Dalits were the victims of the violence. And just imagine that all these people who are supporters of Dalits, and some of them are Dalits themselves, like Professor Anand Teltumde or Sudhir Dhavle, they have been accused of inciting violence. I mean, it is the Dalits who paid the price of violence, and the supporters of Dalits have been put into jail, accusing them of inciting violence. And this whole event was surprisingly organized by two retired justices of High Court of Bombay, Justice Kolse Patil and one other name I forget. So an event organized by esteemed persons as retired judges of High Court, in which prominent intellectuals of the country went and spoke, and there was a violence incited by some outsiders. I will not name them. There are two names. You can find them if you search for them in the internet. But no action taken against them, just because they were aligned with the ruling party, and all these activists are paying the price. And some of them even did not go there, but they have been accused of being part of the Bhima Koregaon conspiracy and are in jail. Now, why is this unfortunate? This is unfortunate because these are very capable people. I mean, as I have mentioned, they are academically very strong. They are very committed to their work. If they have decided to go and work in villages, they go and work in the villages. They stay there. They are not like government officials who use a government vehicle to go in the morning and come back in the evening. They stay in these areas. They have dedicated their lives. A lot of them have had to pay heavy price in terms of, annoying their families or not having any families at all. They are paying a price for all the commitment and the dedication that they had for the common people of this country. So this is the most unfortunate part, because just imagine if they were, and it has now been over 2 years that they are in jail. There was a government in this country which imposed emergency, Indira Gandhi's government, and she also put a lot of such activists in jail. But they were in jail for less than 2 years. They came out, there were elections, Indira Gandhi was defeated, Janata Party came to power, and then all the cases were withdrawn. But now, it has been more than 2 years, and they have been booked under UAPA and serious charges. The law does not allow any bail. The normal course of law is, Manish Bansalji will testify, is that you are innocent until proven guilty. But under UAPA, you are guilty until you are proven innocent. And that is why you don't get a bail. So even if, there is some superficial kind of charge, something which cannot be proved without any concrete evidence, a UAPA case is filed against you, then you cannot be released, because under this law, you have to prove your innocence to come out of jail. You cannot get a bail without that. And the hearing has not started, because the investigation agencies are still doing their work. So the process itself becomes a punishment, especially for people like Stan Swamy and Varvara Rao, who are more than 80 years old, and other activists who have some health problems. There is Gautam Naulakha also, who has been the editor of Economic and Political Weekly. You talk to any social scientist and they will tell you that Economic and Political Weekly is an internationally acclaimed journal, which probably the only one which comes out of India, which has such an international reputation. And he's also in jail just because, he was doing human rights work. He was part of some fact-finding missions in Kashmir and things like that. So just because they were speaking out for the right of the marginalized sections of our population, peoples whose human rights were violated, just because of that, they are in jail. They have not committed any crime. They sometimes the charges are as frivolous as, Maoist literature was found in their homes. Now, Justice Markande Kadzu, when he gave bail to an activist like these, Vinayak Sen, who was in jail during Manmohan Singh's government, he said that just like if you find Gandhi's autobiography in somebody's home, you cannot say that that person is Gandhian. Similarly, you cannot say that because Maoist literature has been found in somebody's home, that person has any link with Maoist. So without any concrete evidence of having committed any crime, all these people are in jail. It is very unfortunate because if they were out, they would have been doing, very important work defending human rights of people, or if nothing, in COVID times, at least they would have been working for the relief of the common people of this country. You know, we ran community kitchens, 23 community kitchens, 12 in Lucknow and remaining outside. Right now, we are running a program where we are offering 5,000 rupees interest-free loan to small vendors and people who carry out small businesses and people whose livelihoods were affected by the lockdown. They find it very useful. Over 250 people have taken such loans from our organization. And so all this work is very important, which helps the poor and the underprivileged people of this country, either in terms of direct relief or defending their human rights. And at this time, when we are passing through such a difficult phase, to keep these such eminent people in jail, I think is really unfortunate for us as a society and as a country. So that is where I will stop, because I think I have taken about more than half an hour. And I would now like to dedicate rest of the time to respond to any queries, or even if you have a comment against something which I have said, you are free to share that and I will try to answer. I can just say that, we can agree to disagree. Whatever you have to say, you are now free to say.
Good evening. There's one question that has come with us. This is a question by Suresh Nautiyal. He's asking for your views on Chardham all-weather road project in Uttarakhand. And simultaneously, he's asking that do destruction and development go hand in hand? Meaning thereby that whatever discussion we have right now regarding protecting the rights of the tribals, the common man, the villagers, vis-a-vis the development which is brought in by the corporates and other things. So we have to balance that. With regard to that, he's asking the question.
I think this is a very good question, because this example will also show the way out, the balance that this person is talking about. So first, let me tell you that Professor G.D. Agarwal was against the Chardham project. So Chardham project is 900 kilometer highway project to connect Gangotri, Yamunotri, Kedarnath and Badrinath. Now, the road which is proposed to be built is very wide. And the Supreme Court formed a team headed by Ravi Chopra, who is an IIT Mumbai graduate and PhD from Rutgers University. He set up an organization called People Science Institute in Dehradun and has done very important work. He was also the chairperson of the committee which was asked to look into the causes of destruction during the 2013 floods. And this committee came out with a report saying that most of the damage was done just before or after the dams, where the dams were built. So, implying that the building of dams, especially in the fragile, you know, ecology of the Himalayas, is very dangerous because, you know, they can become the focal points of destruction. And Ravi Chopra was also the committee, was the head of the committee to look into the Char Dham project. This committee consisted of, I think, about 19 members, and four members, including Ravi Chopra, were against building very wide, highways in the Himalayas, because as Professor G.D. Agarwal used to say, that if you will cut the hills, then you will increase the incidences of landslides. So, because the Himalayas, as you know, are very unstable kind of, they have an unstable constitution and prone to earthquakes. And if you further create damage there, then it can further exacerbate the instability. So the cases of landslide increase as you damage the environment there. And this was the reason why Professor G.D. Agarwal was opposed. And this is the reason why Ravi Chopra was opposed to the construction of very wide highways. So they suggested that according to the government, there's a government order from the Ministry of Highways, which says that which has prescribed the width of the highways in Himalayas, which is half of what it was being built. Less than half of what it was being built in the Char Dham project. And therefore, Ravi Chopra committee said, the four members of Ravi Chopra committee said that just follow your own guidelines and build whatever 5 or 5.5 meter width highway through the Himalayas as part of Char Dham project. Don't build the 12 meter as you are planning. But unfortunately, the rest of the members who were government employees or government nominated members were in favor of the 12 meter width highway, and therefore there was a deadlock, and the Supreme Court had to decide, and ultimately I'm not sure whether the Supreme Court has come out with their decision, but Ravi Chopra was asked to make a presentation before the judges. He has made the presentation. So the point is that even if you want to carry out development, you have to ensure that the damage to the environment is not irreversible. So if you do anything in the name of development, there will be some damage to the environment, but you have to make sure that the damage is limited, or it is such that it can be compensated for. But if the damage is such that it is irreversible or cannot be compensated for example, building the dams on Ganga, especially the upper reaches of Ganga, is something which will irreversibly change the water quality of Ganga. In fact, there is an IIT consortium report which says how much flow at certain points in Ganga should be allowed. This consortium was headed by Professor Vinod Tare of IIT Kanpur, and it has come out with this report. But unfortunately, when Professor and it has come out with a recommendation of roughly 50% flow of the natural flow. So the essentially it says that if you allow 50% flow in Ganga, then the quality of water can be retained. But unfortunately, when Professor Agarwal died, just before that, Nitin Gadkari had agreed to 30% environmental flow, which was not agreeable to Professor Agarwal. So it appears as if the government does not follow its own norms, the rules which are set up by its committees and various mechanisms. It violates its own norms and rules, and therefore the problem is exacerbated.
So taking this question further, this is my question. Since you yourself belongs to the engineering background, yeah, how you see corporates, their CSR initiatives vis-a-vis your vision of performing the social responsibilities? Are their CSR initiatives mere eyewash just to gain the confidence of the people so that they can play with their rights, with their land rights and other villagers' rights, which you are talking about?
जी, इसमें मैं आपको हमारा जो अनुभव है कोका कोला के साथ उसके बारे में थोड़ा सा शेयर करना चाहूंगा. बाकी जनरल कमेंट तो मैं नहीं कह सकता, लेकिन हमारा जो डायरेक्ट एक्सपीरियंस है कोका कोला के साथ, बनारस में एक कोका कोला का प्लांट है, बनारस और इलाहाबाद के बीच में मेहंदीगंज गांव में. अब वहां पे दिक्कत ये थी कि वाटर टेबल नीचे जा रहा था, तो वाटर की क्वालिटी खराब हो रही थी. और उसके ही थोड़ा सा पहले केरल में एक प्लाचीमाड़ा नाम की जगह पे एक प्लांट था, जहाँ पे वहाँ के गांव वालों ने आंदोलन करके उस प्लांट को बंद करा दिया था. और वहाँ पे यही प्रॉब्लम थी कि वाटर टेबल नीचे जा रहा था और पानी टैंकर्स में लाना पड़ रहा था बाहर से. और दूसरी प्रॉब्लम ये थी कि उनका पानी और मिट्टी दोनों जो है उसका वहाँ प्रदूषण हो रहा था. और आपको जान के आश्चर्य होगा कि इतने सारे IITs और साइंटिफिक इंस्टीट्यूशंस होते हुए भी अपने देश के किसी इंस्टीट्यूशन ने वहां के स्लज को टेस्ट करने से मना कर दिया. ग्रीन पीस ने लाचीमाड़ा का स्लज ले जाके यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ एक्सीटर इंग्लैंड में टेस्ट कराया, तो पता लगा उसमें कैडमियम, क्रोमियम और लेड जैसी चीजें हैं. कैडमियम और क्रोमियम कार्सिनोजेन है और लेड से छोटे बच्चों के दिमाग के विकास में बाधा उत्पन्न होती है. तो ऐसी खतरनाक चीजें थी. और कोका कोला कह रहा था कि जो हमारा जो कचरा है इसको आप खेतों में डाल लो, क्योंकि ये खाद का काम करेगा, क्योंकि उसमें थोड़ा सा फास्फोरस भी था. और लोगों ने जब उसको खेत में डाला तो उनके फसल में जो है अनाज का दाना ही नहीं आया, तो वहां के किसान जो है उसके खिलाफ खड़े हो गए. तो यही हाल बनारस में हो रहा था. तो हम लोगों ने आंदोलन किया, तो दो बार मैं वहां जेल में गया, 2003 और 2004 में. और कोका कोला ने क्या किया कि सारे ग्राम प्रधानों को मोबाइल फोन बांट दिए. जो पहले अखबार हमारी खबर छापते थे, उन्होंने खबर तो छापी लेकिन ऐसा लिखा कि कोका कोला का नाम लेना बंद कर दिया, कि ये आंदोलन एक शीतल पेय कंपनी के खिलाफ चल रहा है. और वो इश्यूज के बारे में नहीं लिखते थे कि वाटर टेबल नीचे जा रहा है या पोल्यूशन हो रहा है. वो लिखते थे कि आंदोलनकारियों की तरफ से पत्थर चला, पुलिस ने लाठी चलाई, इतने लोग जेल गए. मतलब वो सारे डिटेल्स देते थे, वो इश्यूज के बारे में नहीं लिखते थे. तो 2005 में, 3-4 में मैं जेल गया, 5 में मुझे अमरीका जाने का मौका मिला. और मैं आपको बताऊं, वो एक ऐसी ट्रिप थी मेरी US की जो यादगार रहेगी, क्योंकि मुझे पहली बार जो गैर भारतीय ग्रुप है उन्होंने बुलाया था, और वो हिंदुस्तान में कोका कोला के खिलाफ जो आंदोलन चल रहा था उसके बारे में जानना चाहते थे. और उस समय यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ मिशिगन एन आर्बर में मैं गया, वहाँ की स्टूडेंट यूनियन में, जिसमें ज्यादातर वाइट स्टूडेंट्स थे, उन्होंने मुझे बुलाया था सुनने के लिए. और कैनेडा में कुछ यूनिवर्सिटीज थी, वाटरलू ओंटेरियो में थी, और कई यूनिवर्सिटीज में जो स्टूडेंट यूनियन वोटिंग करके कोका कोला और पेप्सी को अपने कैंपस से बाहर कर रही थी. मिनेसोटा में तो मैंने देखा कि एक जगह बैनर लगा हुआ था कि बॉयकॉट कोका कोला बिकॉज इट स्टील्स द वाटर ऑफ इंडियन फार्मर्स. एंड किल्स इट्स वर्कर्स इन कोलंबिया. कोलंबिया में उनके कारखाने में उन्होंने अपने कुछ मजदूरों को मरवा दिया था, तो हायर्ड असैसिंस से. तो मुझे बड़ा जान देख के आश्चर्य हुआ कि हिंदुस्तान में कोका कोला के प्रति कोई अवेयरनेस नहीं थी, और अमेरिका में यूनिवर्सिटी स्टूडेंट्स कोका कोला के खिलाफ आंदोलन जो हिंदुस्तान में चल रहा था उसके बारे में जानना चाहते थे. तो मैं एक फिल्म दिखाता था और बहस होती थी. अटलांटा में, जॉर्जिया में जो अटलांटा है वहां पे मुझे जब बुलाया गया, तो जॉर्जिया टेक में, तो वहां पे कोका कोला का हेडक्वार्टर, और मेरी टॉक में कोका कोला का हेड ऑफ वाटर रिसोर्सेज बैठा हुआ था. तो मेरी फिल्म देखने के बाद उसने कहा कि ये सब प्रोपेगेंडा है. तो लोगों ने उससे पूछा कि ये जो पुलिस लाठियां चला रही है ये क्या फेक है आप कह रहे हैं? तो बाद में वो मुझसे मिला, उसने कहा कि मैं आपको अपने हेडक्वार्टर ले चलना चाहता हूँ कि हम जो अच्छा कॉरपोरेट सोशल रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी का काम कर रहे हैं वो मैं आपके साथ शेयर करूंगा. तो मैंने कहा कि देखिए मैं उस आंदोलन में शामिल हूँ, मैं अकेले वहां पे नहीं जा सकता आपके हेडक्वार्टर में, आप ही क्यों नहीं आके मेहंदीगंज में आके बताते हैं कि आप CSR के तहत क्या काम कर रहे हैं. तो खैर वो तो नहीं आया, वो तो एक वाइट अमेरिकन था, उसने अपने इंडियन रिप्रेजेंटेटिव को भेजा मेहंदीगंज में. और आपको बता दें कि मेहंदीगंज गांव बनारस से 15 किलोमीटर दूर है इलाहाबाद हाईवे पे. तो हमने उनसे पूछा कि आपकी वेबसाइट पे लिखा हुआ है कि आप जमीन के नीचे से जितना पानी निकालते हैं, और कोका कोला तो 80% पानी होता है, और अब तो कोका कोला किनले के नाम से पानी की बोतल भी बेचता है, और पेप्सी जो है एक्यूफिना के नाम से पानी की बोतल बेचती है. अब आप बताइए, US के दो मल्टीनेशनल जायंट्स हमारा पानी हम ही को बेच के, और हमारा किसान बेचारा अपने लागत का डेढ़ गुना मूल्य मांग रहा है, हम उसको नहीं दे रहे हैं, और कोका कोला को हम फ्री का पानी 20 रुपए बोतल बेचने की छूट दिए हुए इस देश में. आप देखिए कि कैसी लूट है ये. तो हमने उससे पूछा, उनके रिप्रेजेंटेटिव से, कि भाई आप ये जो वाटरशेड मैनेजमेंट का आपका कार्यक्रम चल रहा है ये कहाँ पे चल रहा है, वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग का जो. तो उसने कहा कि हमारा एक जो हार्वेस्टिंग प्लांट है वो वाराणसी सेंट्रल जेल में. अब आप देखिए वो पानी निकाल रहे हैं बनारस से 15 किलोमीटर दूर, और उनका वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग प्रोग्राम चल रहा है बनारस शहर के अंदर जो जेल है. और मैं जब BHU में पढ़ाने गया तो कोका कोला का दुर्भाग्य था कि मुझे अपॉइंटमेंट केमिकल इंजीनियरिंग में मिला, क्योंकि कंट्रोल सिस्टम मैकेनिकल में भी है, इलेक्ट्रिकल में भी है, और केमिकल में भी है. तो केमिकल इंजीनियरिंग की बिल्डिंग BHU की सबसे बड़ी बिल्डिंग. तो वो क्या करते थे कि ऊपर छत का पानी जो इकट्ठा होता था, जो पाइप से नीचे आता था, उसमें अपना पाइप लगा के उसको एक टैंक में डाल देते थे, और कहते थे ये हमारा वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग प्लांट. मतलब पहले से बनी बनाई बिल्डिंग के ऊपर का पानी इकट्ठा करके बस नीचे एक टैंक बना दिया, और वो भी प्लांट से 15-20 किलोमीटर दूर. तो अब आप समझ लीजिए कि ये जो है ये आई वॉश है कि क्या है. और जब मैं पहुंचा तो वो जो बनाया था उन्होंने वो भी काम नहीं कर रहा था, क्योंकि वो टूटा हुआ था उसका पाइप. तो ये मेरा तो अनुभव ये है कि लोगों के आंखों में धूल झोंकते हैं ये जो बड़ी बड़ी कंपनियां हैं. वो कहती हैं कि हम जितना पानी जमीन से निकाल रहे हैं उतना पानी रिचार्ज कर रहे हैं वाटर हार्वेस्टिंग प्लांट से, लेकिन वो बनारस की कहानी मैंने आपको बताई दी, और किस तरह से उन्होंने ग्राम प्रधानों को मोबाइल फोन बांट के या गाँव के स्कूल की बाउंड्री वॉल बनवा के सारे प्रधानों को, वहाँ के सारे अधिकारियों को और सारे नेताओं को जो MLA MP हैं उनको भी इन्फ्लुएंस करके हम लोग की जो भी शिकायतें थी उन पे कोई भी कार्रवाई नहीं होने. एक पोल्यूशन कंट्रोल बोर्ड ने जरूर उनके खिलाफ एक कार्रवाई की थी, उनके कारखाने को बंद कराया था, लेकिन उनका कारखाना फिर खुल गया, क्योंकि ये बहुत इन्फ्लुएंशियल कंपनीज हैं और ये कहीं ना कहीं से अपना काम निकाल ही लेती हैं. और CSR प्रोग्राम के नाम पे ये सिर्फ लोगों को इन्फ्लुएंस करने का काम करती हैं ताकि इनके खिलाफ कोई कार्रवाई ना हो.
प्लीज सर, देयर इज अनदर क्वेश्चन कमिंग फ्रॉम मिस्टर राहुल कुमार. ही इज आस्किंग व्हाई डू पीपल इन झारखंड एंड इन अदर पार्ट्स ऑफ इंडिया स्टिल हैव टू फाइट फॉर देयर राइट्स why is the large part of India lagging behind in the race to becoming a developed nation? With regard to this question, Lordship, sir, I have to add, is the population, the corruption, or any other abnormality is coming as a bottleneck towards the development of the nation? Or how to balance, as we have already discussing this issue, how the development should go vis-a-vis so that the underprivileged rights are not affected? पॉपुलेशन आपको मैं बताना चाहूंगा कि पॉपुलेशन हमारी जो है वो बहुत तेजी से बढ़ रही है और उसके कारण रिसोर्सेज पे बहुत ज्यादा थ्रस्ट है और अगर थ्रस्ट रहेगा तो डेवलपमेंट ऑब्वियसली करनी पड़ेगी, नहीं तो पब्लिक गवर्नमेंट को तो छोड़ेगी नहीं.
सही बात
है. ऑब्वियसली तो रोड्स हैव टू बी वाइडेंड अप. नाउ आई एम सीइंग इन इवन इन चंडीगढ़ ऑल्सो द टाइम आई केम टू गेट एडमिशन इन पैक एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम वेरी लिमिटेड पीपल आर हैविंग even two wheelers also. Now everybody is having owning at least a car or a four wheeler. So for that purpose, obviously the roads have to be widened. The population is increasing day by day. So is the control of the population, is the control of the population explosion is the main reason, or there are other reasons, or what should be the main things to be addressed to find a solution for this thing?
ये पॉपुलेशन को मैं समस्या इसलिए नहीं मानता हूं क्योंकि हम इस प्रकृति का हिस्सा है और इस प्रकृति में ये हो ही नहीं सकता कि जितने संसाधन है हमको खिलाने पिलाने के लिए जितने होने चाहिए उससे ज्यादा मनुष्य पैदा हो जाए. ये तो हो ही नहीं सकता, नेचुरली पॉसिबल नहीं है, है ना. ये प्रॉब्लम जो आ रही है दो वजहों से आ रही है. एक तो हमने आर्टिफिशियल लाइंस खींच के कंट्रीज बना लिए हैं, तो इंडिया और चाइना अपनी पॉपुलेशन को सप्रेस करने की कोशिश करते हैं और स्कैंडिनेवियन कंट्रीज और कनाडा जो है अपनी पॉपुलेशन को बढ़ाने के लिए इंसेंटिव देते हैं. ऐसा कॉन्ट्रडिक्शन है, ठीक है ना. तो सबसे पहले तो ये जो आर्टिफिशियल बाउंड्रीज हैं इनको खत्म कर देना चाहिए. भाई हमारे जो देशों के बीच की बाउंड्री है वो वैसे क्यों नहीं हो सकती जैसे जिलों और राज्यों के बीच की बाउंड्री है, जैसे यूरोप में हो गया है कि अब वहां बॉर्डर पे कोई पासपोर्ट वीजा की जरूरत नहीं है, कोई सेना की जरूरत नहीं है. तो अगर ये हो जाए तो कुछ पॉपुलेशन रीडिस्ट्रीब्यूशन हो जाएगा, भाई हमारे कुछ लोग चले जाएं स्कैंडिनेविया और कनाडा वगैरह, ठीक है ना. और दूसरी जो प्रॉब्लम है, जो बड़ी प्रॉब्लम है, वो ये कि हमारी जो डेवलपमेंट पॉलिसीज है वो इक्विटेबल नहीं है. उनका जो बेनिफिट है वो इक्विटेबली लोगों तक नहीं पहुंचता है, बल्कि उल्टा हो रहा है. जब से हमने प्राइवेटाइजेशन, ग्लोबलाइजेशन और लिबरलाइजेशन की पॉलिसीज अपनाई है तब से गरीब और अमीर के बीच का फर्क बढ़ गया है. और ये बात आप उस हरेक देश में देखेंगे जहां पे ये पॉलिसीज अपनाई गई. और सिर्फ मैं एक उदाहरण दूंगा कि बांग्लादेश हमारा पड़ोसी है, वो हमारे ही जैसा देश है, 47 के पहले तो हमारा हिस्सा ही था. लेकिन बांग्लादेश ने अपना फीमेल लिटरेसी रेट बढ़ा के और जो वहां पे मोहम्मद यूनुस का जो सेल्फ हेल्प ग्रुप का एक्सपेरिमेंट चला उसमें अपनी महिलाओं को एम्पावर करके उनको काम देके इंडिया में जो वर्किंग वुमेन पॉपुलेशन है 29% है और बांग्लादेश में 56%. तो अपना लिटरेसी रेट बढ़ा के और विमेन को एम्पावर करके फाइनेंशियली उन्होंने अपनी पॉपुलेशन की जो ग्रोथ रेट थी उसको कंट्रोल कर लिया. और याद रखिएगा वो मुस्लिम देश है, क्योंकि हमारे समाज में एक ये भी एक अफवाह है कि मुसलमान ज्यादा बच्चे पैदा करते, ठीक है. तो बांग्लादेश जो कि एक मुसलमान देश है उसका फर्टिलिटी रेट हो गया है 2.1 रिप्लेसमेंट रेट है, यानी कि आपकी पॉपुलेशन बनी रहेगी. अगर एक हस्बैंड वाइफ जो है 2.1 बच्चे पैदा करते हैं एवरेज, तो आपकी पॉपुलेशन बनी रहेगी. वो 0.1 इसलिए है कि कोई बीमारी से, एक्सीडेंट में, अननेचुरल कंडीशंस में कोई मर जाए तो. और इंडिया का जो फर्टिलिटी रेट है वो 2.4 या 2.6 के करीब है, यानी हमारी पॉपुलेशन अभी भी बढ़ रही है, जबकि बांग्लादेश ने अपना पॉपुलेशन ग्रोथ कंट्रोल कर लिया है विमेन को एम्पावर करके. अब दुर्भाग्य ये है कि हिंदुस्तान एक डेमोक्रेसी है, बांग्लादेश तो पूरे टाइम डेमोक्रेसी भी नहीं रहा, और वो आजाद हुआ 71 में जाके, क्योंकि पहले तो वो अंग्रेजों से आजाद हुआ, फिर पाकिस्तान से उसको आजादी लेनी पड़ी। तो 71 में आजाद हुआ देश, उसने डेवलपमेंट पॉलिसीज ऐसी अपनाई कि उसके ह्यूमन डेवलपमेंट इंडेसेस हमसे बेहतर हो गए, उसने अपने पॉपुलेशन एक्सप्लोजन की प्रॉब्लम सॉल्व कर ली और हम नहीं कर पाए। तो ये हमारी डेवलपमेंट पॉलिसीज का फॉल्ट है। और इसमें जो सबसे सबसे जो अहम बात है वो ये है कि अब मैं उस टॉपिक पे बोल दूं जो मेरा जिससे मैंने अपना काम शुरू किया था, एजुकेशन। हमारे देश में कोठारी कमीशन ने 1968 में एक रिकमेंडेशन दी थी कि हिंदुस्तान में कॉमन एजुकेशन सिस्टम लागू करो, यानी हर एक बच्चे को एक जैसा एजुकेशन मिलना चाहिए। ये उस हर एक देश में है जिसने 99% लिटरेसी रेट हासिल किया हुआ है, जिसमें सारे G8 कंट्रीज हैं। आप अमेरिका में चले जाइए तो आपका बच्चा नेबरहुड स्कूल में जाएगा जो सब जगह एक ही जैसा है। उसमें थोड़ा नेबरहुड का फर्क पड़ जाता है, अगर अमीर नेबरहुड है तो स्कूल मटेरियल टर्म्स में थोड़ा बेहतर होगा, लेकिन स्कूल का सिस्टम एक ही है और एजुकेशन फ्री है। अब आप सोचिए, कैपिटलिस्ट कंट्री में स्कूल एजुकेशन फ्री है और हम कहते हैं कि सोशलिज्म का कोई फ्यूचर नहीं है। अमेरिका में जो एजुकेशन का मॉडल है वो तो सोशलिस्ट मॉडल है, और इसी मॉडल से उस हर एक देश ने अपनी 99% बच्चों को एजुकेट किया है कॉमन स्कूल सिस्टम लागू करके, चाहे वो श्रीलंका हो, चाहे ईरान हो, चाहे वो साउथ ईस्ट एशियन कंट्रीज हो, या कजाकिस्तान, उज्बेकिस्तान वगैरह हो। हमारे देश में डेमोक्रेसी होते हुए भी हम उसको लागू नहीं कर रहे हैं। हमारे यहाँ दो तरह की व्यवस्थाएं हो गई हैं कि जो पैसे वाले हैं वो अपने बच्चों को प्राइवेट स्कूलों में पढ़ा रहे हैं, जो गरीब है वो बेचारा अपने बच्चों को सरकारी में भेज रहा है जहाँ पढ़ाई होती नहीं है। तो वो जो एक अमीरी गरीबी का अंतर है वो पढ़ाई के बाद और बढ़ जाता है, क्योंकि पैसे वाले का बच्चा फिर अच्छे कॉलेज में पहुंच जाता है, अच्छी नौकरी मिल जाती है, और गरीब का बच्चा स्कूल छोड़ देता है। अभी हमारे यहाँ ड्रॉपआउट रेट जो है वो इतना हाई है, आधे बच्चे कक्षा 8 के पहले स्कूल छोड़ देते हैं। एक एजुकेशनिस्ट है अनिल सदगोपाल जी, वो कहते हैं हमारे देश में बच्चे स्कूल ड्रॉप आउट नहीं करते, वो वॉक आउट करते हैं, क्योंकि उनको अपना भविष्य नहीं दिखाई पड़ता उस सरकारी स्कूल में। तो ये हमारी सरकार की लापरवाही है कि उसने कॉमन स्कूल सिस्टम लागू नहीं किया। और उत्तर प्रदेश हाईकोर्ट का एक जजमेंट है 2015 का, जस्टिस सुधीर अग्रवाल का, जिन्होंने कहा कि स्कूल सिस्टम को अगर ठीक करना है तो एक ही तरीका है कि जितने सरकारी तनख्वाह पाने वाले लोग हैं इनके बच्चों को सरकारी स्कूल में पढ़ना चाहिए। अब इस जजमेंट को ना तो अखिलेश यादव की सरकार ने लागू किया और ना योगी आदित्यनाथ की सरकार लागू कर रही है। मैंने अरविंद केजरीवाल को कहा कि भैया तुम ही लागू कर दो, हाँ, क्योंकि जजमेंट उत्तर प्रदेश का है लेकिन वैलिड तो सब जगह है, मतलब इसको लागू करेंगे फायदा सबको मिलेगा। तो अरविंद बोलता है कि वैसे ही लोग मेरे दुश्मन है, अब आप जजों और को भी मेरा, मतलब ये सरकारी लोगों को भी मेरा दुश्मन बना दोगे। तो ये दिक्कत है कि ये जो करना चाहिए वो हमारी सरकारें नहीं कर रही है। और इसमें आपको बता दें कि एक किताब आई थी 1991 में, द चाइल्ड एंड द स्टेट इन इंडिया, ऑथर का नाम है माइरन वाइनर, MIT में प्रोफेसर थे सोशल साइंसेस के। और उसी साल बर्कले में हम लोगों ने आशा फॉर एजुकेशन की शुरुआत की थी, मैं, दीपक गुप्ता हमारे मित्र हैं जो IIT कानपुर में पढ़ाते हैं मटेरियल साइंस। उस किताब में ये लिखा था कि हिंदुस्तान में जो ये दोहरी शिक्षा नीति चलाई जा रही है वो इसलिए चलाई जा रही है क्योंकि हिंदुस्तान का जो रूलिंग एलीट है वो ये नहीं चाहता कि जो हिंदुस्तान के गरीबों के बच्चे हैं, जो मासेस के जो बच्चे हैं, और आपको ये बता दें कि मासेस ज्यादातर जो गरीब हैं वो दलित हैं। हमारे एक IIT कानपुर के ही स्टूडेंट उत्तर प्रदेश में IAS अफसर हैं, अमोद कुमार, वो कहते हैं कि हिंदुस्तान में 90% जो गरीब है वो दलित है और 90% जो दलित है वो गरीब है। ये वाक्य दोनों तरफ से सही है कि जो गरीब है उसमें ज्यादातर दलित है और ज्यादातर दलित गरीब है। तो हमारे यहाँ एक कास्ट सिस्टम भी है, ये भी एक प्रॉब्लम है, और ज्यादातर जो निर्णय लेने की पोजीशन पे बैठे हुए हैं वो अपर कास्ट के लोग हैं। तो ये जो अपर कास्ट एलीट है हमारे देश में वो ये नहीं चाहता कि हिंदुस्तान के गरीबों के, दलितों के बच्चे अच्छी शिक्षा पाके उनके बच्चों के साथ आईआईटी और इस तरह के प्रेस्टीजियस कॉलेजेस में प्रवेश के लिए कंपीट करें या अच्छी नौकरियों के लिए या विदेश जाने के अवसरों के, ये मैं नहीं कह रहा हूँ, ये प्रोफेसर माइरन वाइनर कह रहे हैं। उस समय मुझे लगा था कि ये बात सही नहीं है, लेकिन जब मैं सेंट्रल एडवाइजरी बोर्ड ऑफ एजुकेशन में रहा, अर्जुन सिंह जी जब MHRD मिनिस्टर थे, तब मुझे ये बात समझ में आ गई, क्योंकि उस मीटिंगों में जो IAS अफसर बैठता था वो भी यही कहता था कि इस देश में शिक्षा तब सुधरेगी जब IAS अफसर और उसका उसके चपरासी का बच्चा एक ही स्कूल में जाएंगे, यानी कि कॉमन स्कूल सिस्टम लागू होगा। तो ये बात उसको भी मालूम है, लेकिन वो लागू नहीं करता है, तो पॉलिटिकल विल नहीं है। तो इस वजह से हमारा, हम जो है, मुझे, मेरा ये मानना है कि चूंकि हमने अपने अपने बच्चों को सही शिक्षा नहीं दी, और जो दी भी वो ऐसी कि उत्तर प्रदेश में मैं दो जिलों में काम कर चुका हूं जमीनी स्तर पे, एक है बलिया और दूसरा हरदोई, और मैं बिना एग्जेजरेशन के कह सकता हूं कि हमारे करीब 100% बच्चे जो जो ऑर्डिनरी कॉलेजेस में है, जो एलीट कॉलेजेस में नहीं, जो ऑर्डिनरी कॉलेजेस है हर एक जिले के, वो चीटिंग करके अपना 10वीं और 12वीं का इम्तिहान पास करते हैं। आप 5,000 रुपए दे दीजिए, आपके बोर्ड पे आपके सारे प्रश्नों के उत्तर लिख दिए जाएंगे, आप उसको कॉपी कर लीजिए, आपको लिखना नहीं आता है कोई बात नहीं, आप 10,000 रुपए दे दीजिए, आपकी आंसर शीट कोई और लिख देगा। तो इस तरह से जब हमारे बच्चे इम्तिहान पास करेंगे और पढ़ाई का ये हाल रहेगा, तो आप सोचिए कि डेवलपमेंट कैसे होगी।
एक और क्वेश्चन है
जी,
you have talked about the several social activists, you have named several of them in the news also, and previously during the Congress political dispensation, and now the prevalent government, there have been allegations against the social activists that they are hand in glove with the Naxalites and the Maoists. We the people here in North India don't have a concrete definition or fine line of distinction between who can be termed as a pure Naxalite or a Maoist and a free social thinker who works for the society as a social activist. So there is always a sense of confusion, because as you have already discussed in your lecture now, that these people are working at the grassroots level and all that stuff. And secondly, there is a news reporting in the news that these people are associated with the Naxalites. So people, common people who haven't gone to the villages, or like people like us who are living in the urban areas, so how they distinguish what can be called as a Naxalite and a free social thinker, that fine line of distinction. I just want that answer should be concentrated on this thing only, the distinguishing between the two.
देखिए, मैं ये कहूंगा कि, और आप तो लॉयर हैं, आप तो लॉ समझते हैं, कि जब तक कोई व्यक्ति कोई क्राइम ना करे, भाई नक्सलाइट को क्यों बुरा माना जाता है? क्योंकि वो वायलेंस को सपोर्ट करते हैं, तो वायलेंस तो राइट विंग वाले भी करते हैं। भाई हमारे देश में कितने मॉब लिंचिंग इंसिडेंट्स हुए, 4 तो इंटेलेक्चुअल्स को दिन दहाड़े मार दिया गया, नरेंद्र दाबोलकर, गोविंद पंसारे, MM कलबुर्गी जो वाइस चांसलर थे मैसूर यूनिवर्सिटी में, और पत्रकार गौरी लंकेश, भाई तो राइट विंग वायलेंस भी है। तो वायलेंस तो हर एक तरह का बुरा हो, चाहे वो लेफ्ट विंग का हो चाहे राइट विंग का हो। हमारा कहना है कि जो वायलेंस कर रहा है आप उसके खिलाफ कार्रवाई कीजिए, जो आपका लॉ है। लेकिन अगर कोई विचारों से अगर कोई सिंपेथाइजर है किसी एक्टिविटी का, उसके घर में आपको माओइस्ट लिटरेचर मिल गया, वो आप जो है सिर्फ अंदाज पे, क्योंकि वो गरीबों के बीच में काम करता है। देखिए जैसे मेरे साथ है, मैं तो प्योरली गांधियन हूं, मैंने तो मार्क्स भी नहीं पढ़ा, माओ तो दूर की बात है, मैं आपको ईमानदारी से बता रहा हूं। लेकिन चूंकि मैं गरीबों के साथ काम करता हूं, अभी मुझे परसों एक पुलिस वाला मिल गया, तो वो कहने लगा कि भाई हम लोग किसानों के मूवमेंट में प्रोटेस्ट में डिटेन हो गए थे लखनऊ में, हम लोग को साइकिल मोटरसाइकिल रैली निकालनी थी, हम लोग को पुलिस ने डिटेन कर लिया। एक पुलिस वाला पूछता है कि आप हमेशा विपक्ष में ही रहेंगे कि कभी सत्ता में भी जाएंगे? हमने कहा अरे भाई अभी तो हम लोग विपक्ष की ही छोटी पार्टी है हमारी। उन्होंने बोला नहीं नहीं आपकी तो सरकार थी ज्योति बसु की। हमने कहा अरे वो कम्युनिस्ट लोग थे, हम सोशलिस्ट लोग हैं। तो फिर मैंने उसको समझाया कि डॉक्टर राम मनोहर लोहिया, आचार्य नरेंद्र देव, जयप्रकाश नारायण, ये सब सोशलिस्ट लीडर हैं। तो चूंकि हम गरीबों के साथ काम करते हैं तो मान लिया जाता है कि ये जो है कम्युनिस्ट है, नक्सलाइट है, हाँ माओइस्ट है। लेकिन ज्यादातर जो लोग हैं इस देश में जो गरीबों के साथ काम कर रहे हैं वो नक्सलाइट थोड़ी ना, नक्सलाइट तो है लेकिन वो जंगलों में है, जो अपना का जो अपने तरीके से लड़ाई लड़ रहे हैं। और वो लड़ाई लड़ रहे हैं, मतलब इस देश में अभी भी छत्तीसगढ़ राज्य में कुछ जमीन है जिसपे भारत सरकार का कब्जा नहीं है क्योंकि वो नक्सलाइटों के कब्जों में। तो जो गलत काम कर रहे हैं, जो वायलेंस का इस्तेमाल कर रहे हैं, आप उनके खिलाफ कार्रवाई कीजिए। लेकिन कोई इंटेलेक्चुअल है, कोई प्रोफेसर है, कोई लॉयर है जो खुद वायलेंस नहीं कर रहा है, सिर्फ गरीबों के अधिकारों की बात कर रहा है। जैसे इस समय हम अभी ये सारे एक्टिविस्ट के लिए एक सिग्नेचर कैंपेन चला रहे हैं क्योंकि हमें लगता है कि ये लोग जो है ये इनोसेंट है, इन्होंने खुद कोई क्राइम नहीं किया है। मतलब वर्स्ट केस में हो सकता है सिंपेथाइजर हो। तो भाई ये हकीकत है कि इस देश में जो गरीब लोगों के अधिकार की बात करते हैं वो ज्यादातर कम्युनिस्ट लोग करते हैं, और कुछ सोशलिस्ट हैं, कुछ अम्बेडकराइट हैं, कुछ गांधीयन हैं। तो लेकिन आप सबको अगर आप एक ही रंग से रंग दोगे और आप कहोगे कि ये सारे नक्सलाइट हैं तो वो तो उनके साथ अन्याय है। तो मुझे लगता है कि टेस्ट ये होना चाहिए कि आपने कोई ऐसा एक्ट किया है जो क्राइम माना जाता है, तब बिल्कुल आपके खिलाफ कार्रवाई होनी चाहिए। लेकिन अगर आप सिर्फ वैचारिक रूप से अगर आप समर्थक हैं गरीबों के अधिकारों की लड़ाई के, जैसा कि इनमें से बहुत सारे लोग थे, सुधा भारद्वाज कोई नक्सलाइट नहीं है और ना उनके नक्सलाइट से कोई लिंक है, ये मैं इसलिए बता सकता हूँ क्योंकि वो मेरी मित्र है। आनंद तेलतुंबडे के भाई है माओइस्ट, आनंद तेलतुंबडे खुद नहीं है, आनंद तेलतुंबडे ने कहा है। अब किसी का भाई माओइस्ट हो और उसलिए आप उसको माओइस्ट बता के बंद कर दें, ये तो वैसे ही है कि जैसे कहीं कोई घटना हुई और पुलिस को अपराधी नहीं मिल रहा है तो पुलिस किसी फैमिली वाले को पकड़ के ला के थाने में बैठा लेते। तो और बल्कि मैं तो ये पढ़ रहा था कि किसी बैंड ऑर्गेनाइजेशन का मेंबर होना भी अपने आप में क्राइम नहीं है। भाई इस देश में तो आरएसएस कम से कम 2 बार बैन हो चुकी है और कितने लोग आरएसएस के मेंबर हैं। तो किसी बैंड ऑर्गेनाइजेशन का मेंबर होना भी अपने आप में क्राइम नहीं है जब तक आप खुद कोई क्राइम ना करें। मुझे लगता है कि ये टेस्ट होना चाहिए, ये कसौटी होनी चाहिए। और अगर आप सिर्फ वैचारिक रूप से गरीबों के अधिकार की लड़ाई का समर्थन कर रहे हैं तो उसमें कोई ये बात नहीं होनी चाहिए। बल्कि मैं तो ये कहूंगा कि देखिए बहुत सारे लोग हैं, आपने कई बार सुना होगा कि अन्ना हजारे कहते थे कि जो करप्शन कर रहा है उसको पकड़ के फांसी पे चढ़ा दो। अब आप लॉयर हैं, हाँ अपने देश के लोगों की समझ में मुझे तरस आता है। एक दिन मैं धरने पे बैठा था उसी समय जब इंडिया अगेंस्ट करप्शन का आंदोलन चल रहा था, और वो लोग कह रहे थे हमारे डिस्ट्रिक्ट मजिस्ट्रेट को कि जो भी करप्शन कर रहा है आप उसको पकड़ो और उसको जो है आप फांसी की सजा दे दो। तो लोगों को ये भी नहीं मालूम कि भाई कोई लीगल प्रोसीजर होता है, आप किसी को पकड़ेंगे तो उसके खिलाफ चार्ज बनेगा, मुकदमा चलेगा, उसका क्राइम प्रूव होगा, तब वो उसको सजा मिलेगी। और करप्शन की सजा फांसी नहीं होती है। तो लोग तो ये भी एक भाई आप इस तरह से, तो बहुत सारे लोग हिंसा का समर्थन करते हैं कि इसको मार डालो उसको मार डालो। बहुत सारे लोग हैं, अभी हमारे अमिताभ कंठ जी ने कह दिया जो इसके नीति आयोग के हेड है कि टू मच डेमोक्रेसी इज नॉट बेनिफिशियल। तो इस तरह के बहुत सारे लोगों के विचार होते हैं जो डेमोक्रेसी और कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन के खिलाफ है, लेकिन सबको तो आप जेल नहीं भेजते हैं ना। तो मेरा ये कहना है कि सिर्फ विचार के आधार पे अगर कोई समर्थक है गरीबों के अधिकारों की लड़ाई का तो उसको जेल भेजना अन्याय है।
प्लीज सर, सो वी आर फॉलिंग शॉर्ट ऑफ टाइम, वन लास्ट क्वेश्चन।
जी जी,
वी जस्ट वांट द आंसर विद अ वन लाइनर।
जी जी,
इट्स अ काइंड ऑफ ऑब्जेक्टिव टाइप क्वेश्चन।
जी जी, बताइए बताइए।
इट्स अ रिगार्डिंग यू सर, What was the trigger for you that put the activist inside you in action?
ये तो yes no वाला question नहीं है, ये तो subjective.
But you have to give the answer in a single line.
तो मेरा जो activist बनने का जो मेरा मेरी जो प्रेरणा थी वो गांधी जी की जो आत्मकथा थी वो पढ़ के आई जब मैं PHU में इंजीनियरिंग पढ़ रहा था. और ये तय हो गया था कि मेरा इंजीनियरिंग में इंटरेस्ट नहीं है, मुझे जो काम गांधी जी ने किया उस तरह का कुछ काम करना है. मतलब वो मेरे रोल मॉडल बन गए. और ये मुझे जो उनकी सबसे जो जिस चीज ने मुझे आकर्षित किया वो ये थी कि वो एकदम गरीबों के बीच में रह के काम करते थे. मतलब वो उस तरह के इंटेलेक्चुअल नहीं थे कि वो सिर्फ गरीबों की बात करते थे, उनकी प्रॉब्लम के सोल्यूशंस देते थे, लेकिन वो उनके बीच में जाके काम करते थे. ये मॉडल मुझे बहुत पसंद आया और इसलिए मैंने उसी मॉडल को अपने जीवन में अपनाया है और मैं अपने निर्णय से खुश हूँ. हाँ, मुझे कभी भी इस बात का कोई वो नहीं रहा कि मैंने गलत निर्णय लिया. और मैं जो काम करता हूँ उसी में मुझे सुख मिलता है, इसीलिए मैं ये काम करता हूँ. मैं कोई सेक्रीफाइस वगैरह मैंने नहीं की है. मैं हर एक इंसान वही करता है जो उसको पसंद आता है, जिसमें वो सुखी रहता है. तो मुझे वहां से प्रेरणा मिली, मुझे ये लगा कि वो करने में ही मैं खुश रहूंगा, इसलिए मैं वो काम कर रहा हूँ और ये मेरे लिए स्वाभाविक है.
प्लीज सर, सो वी आर फॉलिंग शॉर्ट ऑफ टाइम, बट लॉन्ग लिस्ट ऑफ क्वेश्चंस फॉर यू
जी
फ्रॉम माय साइड आल्सो एंड फ्रॉम द
नहीं तो मैं ऐसा करता हूँ कि मैं चैट बॉक्स में अपना ये लिख देता हूँ, पर ये तो सब नहीं देख पाएंगे. तो मेरा ईमेल एड्रेस आप नोट कर लें, जो भी लोग अभी सवाल नहीं पूछ पाए मुझे ईमेल भेज दीजिएगा, aashaashram@yahoo.com पे. ASHA जो मेरी संस्था का नाम है और फिर आश्रम ASHRAM, ये एक आशा आश्रम मेरा केंद्र है लखनऊ से 60 किलोमीटर दूर हरदोई जिले में, आशा आश्रम विदाउट एनी ब्रेक और @yahoo.com. तो आपके जो भी सवाल होंगे उनके मैं जवाब देने की कोशिश करूंगा. और जैसा मैंने पहले कहा, अगर आप की मेरे विचारों से असहमति है तो भी आप कहिए, क्योंकि असहमति से ही लोकतंत्र चलता है. असहमति को हम खत्म कर देंगे तो हम चाइना जैसे हो जाएंगे.
सर, वी हैड अ वेरी गुड सेशन विद यू with regard to the social rights and the social activism. You have given us a very insight thought and about the various people working into this arena, and the question and answer round was very informative, and we really thank you. You have come on board of our alumni portal and shared your views with regard to the various problems facing our country, and obviously you have given the solutions to some extent so that the social ill wills are removed and our country progresses to a new era of development. I on behalf of the PEC alumni I'm thankful to Divya ma'am also, Dr. Sanghi, director of Punjab Engineering College Institute of Technology, and other supporters of the team and the background team who had done a wonderful act to so that our session goes very smoothly. And we are really privileged to have you on your board, and definitely we will like to share our views and get your views also through the medium of your